What question pops up in your mind when you hear the question, open everything?
The question that pops up in my mind is, how can we discuss something like this while avoiding the danger of not focusing on practical solutions and pragmatic thinking? You know, the past couple of days we've been discussing a lot, open everything, but a lot of the discussions have been really sort of up in the air and, you know, floating in the sky, you know, talking to the clouds like the Socrates play. And I think it's nice to be able to have those theoretical discussions, but I think I'm sort of fed up and I want maybe to discuss the legal and also technological solutions and discussions that maybe we can have towards convincing both the legal, you know, lawmakers and the legal system, and also developing and testing and improving and releasing the technology towards achieving, you know, perhaps a more open society or better internet technology, or defeating surveillance, or reinstating more privacy protections for everyone.
You're talking about discussing how to do it. What fields, experts of what fields would be interesting to you to discuss the whole situation?
The fields are not small in number. Definitely a lot of people can contribute. You can have political activists, you can have political theorists, lawmakers, policy analysts, intelligence experts, foreign policy experts, people who you can even bring in people who have experience in the demands of law enforcement, for example, to see how this can be balanced with that side of the political spectrum. And you can also, this is from the legal side. From the technical side, you can bring in political, computer programmers, designers, user interface experts, beta testers, cryptography experts, privacy experts, people who can test the software and see if it works and see if people know how to use it. So between all that, I mean, anyone can contribute to one of those fields, but it's not a matter of, you know, how much expertise and how much of an expert you are in one of those fields, but, you know, perhaps more of a matter of the questions that are being proposed. You know, instead of let's think and not really do anything, I think it's kind of annoying to me. I wish this conference had a more of a let's get stuff done instead and stop, you know, thinking at each other and just, you know, trying to find things to say to each other that make us sound smart. I think, you know, this is nice, but also for example, yesterday a person in the audience named Jake Applebaum had some, you know, he was really the only person that I could identify with, because he was identifying concrete issues in the internet, concrete engineering issues, concrete privacy issues, and saying this is how we can fix them. And I wish people on the panels were doing that too.
If you don't find these people right now, right here, mm-hmm. Where else do you find those people?
Oh, well, I mean, I think a lot of them are right here. I don't think these are the wrong people. That's not what I said. But I think the questions that are being asked and the sort of agenda is just not practical. We need a practical agenda. The people here are people that are excellent and that I can learn from. But I think perhaps the sort of train track that we set for ourselves for this entire event should have been more hands-on. And I think, for example, one of those people, Jake Applebaum, gave the intro keynote, and also Birgitta. For example, another person, Birgitta Jónsdóttir, the parliamentary person from Iceland, gave an amazing discussion on how, in fact, in Iceland, they took advantage of the political situation and established and passed some really interesting laws. For example, they passed the IMI media privacy law, and that made Iceland offer a lot of journalistic protections to people. And this is, you know, an actionable, practical difference. You know, we passed a law. This law gave journalists access. We held interesting meetings, and we learned a lot from the Icelandic political situation about how democracy works. And this is what we did, and this is what we learned from it. And this story happened 3 years ago, maybe even more. And I've heard it from Birgitta many times, but every time I hear it, it's still useful, and it's still something that I learned from even more because of the perspective and the experience that comes with discussing actionable real issues like that. And this is, you know, both of them, both Brigitte and Jacob gave the, I think, the intro, the introductory like opening speech. And that was really the best part for me, because I think, you know, those people are here, and since we have the amazing people that we have at this conference, we should be using their talents to solve real problems, you know, instead of, for example, yesterday, people were talking about how this is a post-privacy world. And, you know, like, if we're all here in the middle of Graz together, maybe it's better to, you know, not necessarily, you know, come and meet so that we can agree on how defeated we are, but come and meet so that we can identify the problems we can solve and solve them, or try to work towards solving them.
Speaking of your personal interest, in which direction do you personally work to fight against this defeat?
Well, personally, I work on software called CryptoCat. It's an easy to use chat app. You know, like Facebook chat is really easy to use. That's why all your friends, I'm assuming, use it. CryptoCat is just as easy to use, but at the same time, it encrypts all your conversations automatically, so that everything you do on it is private from the start, and there's no barrier to prevent you from knowing how to use it, because encryption software tends to be hard to use, and so unless you're like specialized in that field, it might be too hard for you. And so CryptoCat, you know, it's more experimental, it's more new, so it's not, you know, sort of as safe as encryption software that's been used by militaries and so on, but it's open source and transparent and free, and it makes encryption fun and accessible. And so, you know, I guess you can see my bias. I want to do things that, you know, immediately people can start using now. And with CryptoCat, this is what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to offer a nice, you know, colorful, easy to use, accessible chat app. It's available in 35 languages, and it has complete privacy measures. And already, you know, we have tens of thousands of people who use it.
Do you think this is the future of our internet, or do you hope it's the future of our internet to keep our privacy, to keep our personal information to ourselves?
Well, it's very important to recognize that in places like these conferences, we are all the people that come here are part of a certain intellectual side. And, you know, maybe 0.00001% of the world or of the society that we share thinks the way we do. Not a lot of people think the way we do, and not a lot of people even care about the internet, or, you know, even perceive the internet very slightly similarly to the way we do. So, you know, whether this is the way the internet is heading, I don't really know. I mean, we're the people who really care about this stuff, but our views are really not shared by the majority of the population. Because not because people disagree with us, but because they don't care the same way we care. It's like caring a lot about refrigerators, you know? Like, why would you do that? I mean, it's not as silly as refrigerators, but at the same time, it's a very specialized interest to a lot of people. That's what it looks like. Unfortunately, this is a bad thing. But, so that's a bad thing. But, I mean, I would hope that, I mean, projects like CryptoCat are not going to solve the problem. They're going to offer maybe a small alternative for people to rely on if they want. And this is a nice thing to have. It's nice to have this alternative that exists for you if you ever need it. But I think the real solution, unfortunately, will not come. I think Rob Gongrijp said this. He's from Amsterdam or from the Netherlands. He said that this is going to take some time, because it's going to take some time for the values of what's wrong with removing privacy from the internet to really be understood by society. Because not because society is stupid, but because society is composed of a lot of people who come from really different backgrounds. You know, I come from a background that is a computer background, but that doesn't mean that, you know, my mother, who grew up as a journalist, comes from a computer background, you know, or that my neighbor, who is a school teacher, you know, those people, they're not the same way. I didn't understand, you know, global warming or transgender issues from the first time I heard them. They're not going to understand internet privacy or why it's important from the first time they hear it. And so we have to wait until all those people from all those different backgrounds understand why this is important. And then, you know, maybe, I mean, I'm optimistic about the democratic system. Maybe it's because I'm young, but maybe through, you know, legislative action, we can hopefully get the European Union and then the US and then the UN and then, you know, more and more people like that to adopt the same way it's going to be, you know, the same way how racism was slowly defeated in the US, you know, old and not very related example, but at the same time, it took a lot of time. And the same thing, this is, it took a lot of time because it took a lot of time for it to people to realize that it's socially unacceptable to have slaves, you know, of course it is. But now, you know, to me and you, of course it's socially unacceptable to have internet surveillance to this degree and with this kind of lack of oversight. But to a lot of people, they don't realize it yet. And so slowly, as this becomes a more social thing, I hope that with a combination of, you know, hardworking people who can solve the engineering problems and also regular citizens who can be part of the political and social and democratic process, we can eventually get over it. But I mean, I'm afraid it's going to take some time and a lot of luck also.